Welcome to the Startup Grind.
So, good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. First question, who is here for the first time to Startup Grind? Raise your hands. Okay, so I think that's more than half of the room. I'll start by just a short introduction of what we do. We are an organization that started in Silicon Valley in 2010 with the mission to help every entrepreneur on the planet. That's a very bold statement. And so in those 7 years since then, we have spread to 200 cities around the world, and we have impacted over 1 million entrepreneurs. So we are slowly getting there. How we do this? At our events, we try to connect entrepreneurs with investors, advisors, mentors, or with fellow entrepreneurs so they can help each other, and also through our network globally. So this is one of the events that we have. And we try to invite an inspiring guest, just like tonight. So we have a former investment banker with an MBA from Harvard who turned to an angel investor and a startup CEO. Jozef Barta, please give him a warm welcome. And before we begin, you have the Wi-Fi passwords on those small black papers around. And if you go to slido.com and use the hashtag, you can ask questions and vote on the best ones, and I promise that they will be answered. And one more thing, on every chair there was a feedback form, and we are really just having the third event, so if you have any tips on what to improve or what you like, that will help us. So, Jozef, we are very happy, honored that we have you here. You have an amazing career path. But let's go back all the way to the beginnings.
Okay.
So, where do you come from? How did you grow up?
I come from Slovakia. I grew up in Bratislava. And as you said, so I studied in Bratislava during the old communist times still. And after the revolution, I was very lucky. I mean, it was a coincidence, really. And I applied for an MBA without even knowing properly what MBA meant. But I got into Harvard Business School, where I graduated in 1993, and came back to already divided Czechoslovakia, came back to Prague and spent 6 years working for, which was then called Credit Suisse First Boston. Now it's called Credit Suisse, an investment bank.
Okay, you started off really quick. So
yeah.
I'll slow it down a little bit. So what motivated you as a child? Why did you choose your career path? Did you have some idols or?
As a child, I don't recall idols, but I studied finance, which obviously in the communist times was very different. But still was quite interesting for me. But as I said, after graduation, I only spent really 2 years working before the revolution came. So wasn't really a meaningful career during those times.
So you knew already from a young age that, yeah, I want to study finance, I will become a banker?
Not really. But it was just some kind of a natural path I took and wasn't really planning on too much. For some reason, I studied the most energy I put into at school was studying English without even ever hoping that to be able to travel or to get out of the country at that time. But there was some instinct, I guess. I learned English.
Yeah. But that's interesting that you eventually had the chance to go out. Mm-hmm. And so you did an MBA at one of the best schools, and you had a job in the US. Mm-hmm. So you worked there briefly, but you still decided to come back. What was this work experience in the US?
Actually, it was an interesting one because when I applied, to HBS, they had a condition that you have to have some practice working, some job practice. Since Harvard Business School does only case study method, there's no lectures. and they want everybody to contribute from their own experience. So they want everybody to spend at least 2 years working, which I did, but that didn't really count in the non-market economy. So they said you have to come to the US and spend some time working. So I spent.
So before going to the MBA, you had to go work.
Yeah.
And then,
yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I went to New York and I spent almost a year working for Colgate-Palmolive, which is the famous toothpaste maker. And so.
And your dream came true. I think for a lot of people, you know.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
You leave the communist country.
Sure.
And yeah. But you still came back.
I came back. I think mainly for family reasons I came back. Was really hard to come back. I guess after 3 years there, I really Boston is a beautiful city and everything was nice. And but for family reasons, I have to say I came back to Europe. So
okay, and so you were working as an investment banker.
Yeah.
What did you do at these times? I think it was a very different market than nowadays. There was
those were really fun times because I started trading on the Prague Stock Exchange in 1993, and that was the year when the Prague Stock Exchange already existed, but it really took off a few months after I joined, and some big US investment funds discovered Prague and they started to invest heavily, and they were buying everything. The funny thing was that Credit Suisse or CSFB, we were the only brand they would recognize from all the members of the Prague Stock Exchange. I mean, some US investment bank or trader, if he looked at the list of the members of the Prague Stock Exchange, he saw names like Komerční banka, Česká spořitelná.
How was it possible that there was no other?
There was nobody. We were the
foreign,
only ones.
Okay.
Well, the reason was Credit Suisse First Boston had a guy, his name was Hans-Jörg Rudloff, the famous guy who invented Eurobonds. So he had this vision that in Central Eastern Europe, you need to have local presence. And it was a brilliant idea, and it worked for about, 10 years. Mm. And we had a huge advantage because we had locals, and at that time, most of the management of local companies didn't speak any English. So if an investment banker came from London, with an interpreter, we had a much easier job connecting to these guys. So we were the only name they would recognize, and there was two of us, two traders at that time in the office, and we did about 95% of the volume of the Prague Stock Exchange because we had all the orders. So that was fun.
That sounds like you could easily manipulate.
You know what? That's funny because when I did it for about 3 years, and
I hope
after I left, I realized I could have made a ton of money. You know, it never crossed my mind that I could have done front running and only insider trading. It just didn't cross my mind. So after I left, I said, Jesus, I could have been a billionaire by now.
Especially probably the regulation was not even
there. Was
strong.
Nothing. Yeah. There was nothing. We could do whatever we wanted. I mean, there was no regulation locally. There was no regulation. Even the guys from London who were our bosses didn't really know what we were doing. They were just happy we delivered the revenue. So.
Okay. So you eventually switched industries. You went to telco.
Yeah, I went back to Slovakia because I had children. I had twins who were born here in Prague. And so we decided with my wife to move back to Slovakia. I got this job offer to join a company named EuroTel, which some of you may recognize because it existed also here in Czech Republic. It's a mobile phone operator.
Was this experience kind of like entrepreneurial? Because I know the company was in distress and you came in kind of to rescue and turn it around?
Well, it was the most intense working experience for me ever, because it was a company that was basically at the verge of bankruptcy. Nobody knew, and obviously we couldn't tell people because everybody would have left us. But it was really, we were defaulting on bank loans, and the banks were, sort of circling. And my main task was to refinance. So we did at the end of the day, we did after some restructuring, some organizational changes we did in the company, we did a Eurobond issue, which was actually we were the first bond issue out of Slovakia that was even listed on in New York through SEC, Mm-hmm. It was the first and the last. It never happened again. And so we did quite a successful bond issue, refinanced the company, and then from then on it went quite well, actually.
And what do you think was the key success that you actually managed to know?
Well, it was I just was lucky. We had a great team. We had a great team of people. I think we were able to motivate, because I came to a company that was not only in a bad shape financially, but the whole team, I mean, all the employees were demotivated. You have to imagine it was a company that started doing mobile phones for 6 years, had a monopoly position. And after 6 years, they came a competitor, and within 1 year, they went in market share from 100% to, I believe, the lowest we reached was like 36.
Okay.
In 1 year, that's pretty bad. So the whole, all the employees, they felt like we are doomed and that's it. And so it was really difficult to, I think the main challenge was to motivate them again and to believe that we can do it. And
so you actually kept the people, just tried to, you know?
Not all. Okay, from obviously some people from the management had to leave because they were part of the problem, but most of the team was there still.
And you were there for 3 years?
3 years.
So what was the result after you left?
Well, the result was one that I was always very proud of, although it was never really published, but I know that we had a 49% shareholder was a consortium of US telephone companies or mobile companies, AT&T and some other, and they had a consortium that invested in Central Europe in mobile operators. And the finance guy, my CFO, who was part of the US structure, he told me that they had written us off. So on their balance sheet, EuroTel Slovakia was zero. They refused to provide more equity. They said, well, this investment just didn't work out. Okay, the Czech one worked, the Hungarian worked, Slovakia is written off to zero. And so when I left, the Germans actually paid them $500 million for the stake. So that was...
That's a pretty good investment. But it's interesting that I don't recall anything from the news that EuroTel, you know, would have some problems.
Well, it was really dangerous because we really had to keep a tight lid on the information, because the competition between, although there were only two of us, the competition was so fierce that if there was any rumor that we were in financial trouble, we would have been done. Hmm. I mean, it was, funnily enough, the CEO of then our competitor, which is now Orange, we are now very good friends, personally. But at that time, we were like suing each other every month. Basically, every month I would send him a letter for that advertising that was saying something that was not true, and vice versa. So it was really intense. So very, very few people knew that we had financial trouble.
Hmm. Okay, so was it like your decision that you felt like you finished your mission and then you wanted a new challenge?
No, I have to admit I didn't get along with the new shareholders, which were the Deutsche Telekom.
And that was after the sale?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then you.
So they fired me, basically.
And I guess you didn't have to wait long for a new job after.
It was
such
1 year,
success.
Actually. After 1 year, I got I had a sort of sabbatical for 1 year, and then I was approached by a headhunter to take a position in UniCredit, Slovak Bank.
During this 1 year, were you thinking about, you know, founding a company?
Not really. I was still this corporate animal that it never crossed my mind I should become an entrepreneur.
You had a lot of experience from the market and the network of people.
I have to say I basically probably wasted this year, pretty much. The 3 years were so. I mean, the 3 years were so so intense that I literally worked 20 hours a day. You know, it was really intense because it was risky and we always felt the tension. And so I spent 1 year really just taking off and then joined the corporate again.
And what was like, that was more a smooth ride, just keep everyone happy?
Well, it wasn't. I mean, it was we had a sort of a few fun moments there. I mean, I was running a bank that was mid-sized, wasn't one of the largest in Slovakia. It was similar to the experience with EuroTel, to the extent that one had to motivate people because they were sort of not really happy in their jobs. Mm-hmm. And so what we did was we hired a lot of new people there. And we had a few fun moments, which was like the introduction of Euro, which is always a very challenging thing. Then we merged with another bank, which was HVB, a German bank, German-Austrian at the time. So those were sort of very interesting times. But then, like you said, it became a little bit more boring.
But it seems like you have really a lot of experience with like motivating people. What do you think are the key things for, to keep your employees happy? What should a good manager do?
Well, I think it always depends on the situation. I mean, it's, I remember the most intense experience was in EuroTel where it was extreme. That they were, the company was full of young people. They were really, in their 20s, maybe 30s. And they were already, one felt like they are done. I mean, they totally resigned and they were like, we are done and that's it.
Is it because they were like working a lot and there was no result?
And they saw that they were losing market share like crazy. And in the bank, it was different because in the bank, it was more like I had to hire a lot of new people and get rid of a lot of existing people because the culture was not right. Mm-hmm. So it was two different, very different situations. Both were sort of, one had to motivate the people, but it was two different situations in terms of what I found there.
So was it like setting up, smaller goals that slowly they can build up the confidence to do?
Oh yeah, absolutely, things? Absolutely. Like we did a first campaign where we beat the competitor, okay. And so I was running around the company telling everyone, look, we can do it. So
it's that actually sounds like a startup culture already.
Yes, except in startup it's every day.
Okay. So while you were the CEO at UniCredit. You started, you got interested in art and started buying. I know, I saw an interview with you where you had your office full of paintings.
Yeah. Well, it was a coincidence. I mean, that's something where, the company I'm working for now, we are in art and it's a startup that is making it easier for people to invest in art, even if they don't know art. Or they don't understand art, or they never cared about it.
So was that your case?
But yeah, it was my case. I mean, and our goal in ARTSTAQ today, in the company where I work now, is that we want to turn some of these people to become collectors. And I always say that there's very small percentage of people who are collectors. In general population, that's true everywhere. It's in terms of the number of people involved in the art market is a small market. It's huge in terms of the financial size, but everyone has his own story how he became a collector. And for me, I never had it in my family. My parents never took me to galleries, etc. But we just happened to sponsor one event for our private clients, which happened to be in an auction house. So I went there and I participated in an auction and bought some crappy pictures, something worthless for a lot of money. And so I did it like three times.
But did you like the picture?
I liked it. Yeah, it was nice. And then the head solicitor in that, the head, I don't know what's the English word for it, the auction person who is, doing the auctions. She came to me, and we are friends until today, and she came to me and was like, let's talk. She saw I was spending money on things that were sort of worthless. And so then I started to study things and I started to learn about art. And so I became, I became a collector of young artists. But I think everyone has his own story, how he becomes, he or she becomes a collector. So, and we just want to, one of our goals is to turn a few of these investors into collectors.
Okay. So to change the mindset a little bit.
Yeah.
Okay. And, so you started collecting art still at the bank, and after you left, you started investing in startups, which for me is very interesting because a banker is very risk averse. You have to be careful.
Yeah.
And then venture capital and startups, especially angel investing, is probably the most risky thing you can do.
It is. I mean, I had a little comfort in a way that I didn't do it alone. I have a partner who actually sort of talked me into it, and so we started to have a lot of discussions. And actually, I was even looking at things even during my working in the bank. So we looked at a few startups, and we've invested jointly. small amounts of money. And basically, after 10 years in the bank, I decided to leave because it was became just very boring.
Just a routine.
Very routine. And the regulation that is coming on banks every year is stronger and stronger. And so it became really frustrating. I mean, if I compared my first year and the last year in the bank, and the amount of bureaucracy one has to deal with, it became really frustrating experience. So I said, I want to try something else. So I decided to leave. First, as I said, with my partner, we invested in a few startups. Then I became involved in ARTSTAQ. So I have to say, as an entrepreneur, I really have nothing to tell you because you know most of you are more experienced in entrepreneurship than I am, because I'm a real newcomer in entrepreneurship. So
I'm sure you have a lot of experiences. So you said that you had a friend that introduced you to these mm-hmm. investments, but what do you look for in an investment?
Well, I think we looked at something where we felt there was a great product and great person behind it, and we've invested in about three or four ventures, so it's not like, you know, a huge portfolio that I have. It's like three or four ventures.
Over what time period?
Over probably 3 years. Okay. So it wasn't crazy. I mean, I didn't come out of the bank super rich, so. We've invested in a few ventures. Some of them are still alive and doing. Actually, one of them is doing really well. So, I'm hoping everything will work out. If the 1-4 ratio would be great.
Oh yeah, I think that's in this industry is really good. So, do you see any ways how your past career in the corporate prepared you for the startup life?
Well, it's interesting because I work with people who are, you know, most of them are like 20 years younger than me, and I'm learning from them. So because they've been doing this for more years than I am, I'm talking entrepreneurship and startups. So it's great because I can learn from them. Hopefully, they learn something from me since we are a startup that focuses on financial investments. So there's certain things that I can contribute from my experience, but in general I have to say I'm mostly learning a lot from mm-hmm. from the team that I'm working with, and keeps me younger. You know, I will work with the young people, so it's great. Yeah, it's fun.
So what were some of the most interesting things that you learned that would be maybe not possible in the corporate world?
Well, clearly it's the freedom. I mean, it's in the corporate world, even when some of my people had the best idea and they came to me, I said, okay, let's do it. And I was the CEO and we still couldn't do it because this whole corporate culture swallows you. I mean, it's just like so difficult. And here, if you have an idea and if we vote on it and there's six of us in the room and we decide we do it. So it's very different.
So it's much easier decision process.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And I think, you know, it shows. I mean, I have to say, you know, if you read the newspapers, I mean, the smartest CEOs today of the global corporations are the ones who admit they can't do it. Mm. I mean, they are the ones saying, you know, innovations, we can't do it. I mean, we're just too big, too bureaucratic. And so they're looking at startups to do the innovations for them. And then they maybe buy them or they use their product, but they are actually admitting they can't do it.
And so how did you find out about ARTSTAQ? Was it also maybe just first, okay, this is an interesting investment
no,
opportunity?
I was actually approached by the founder, because I'm not the founder. So we have a founder whose name is Roman Komarek, who is a visionary, and he came up with this whole idea. He's a brilliant guy. And he approached me because he found me through this combination of, okay, former banker and art collector, so that works. And the chemistry works between us, and so we started to work.
How
together.
Early was this in the company?
Say it again.
How early was this?
Very early, when the idea was just on paper.
Okay, so there was no
working product.
But that means that you were there already from the beginning,
yes,
right?
I was, but what he did was the work he did before took like 3 years to come up with the whole thing. You know, so it's.
And how did he convince you, you know, to join?
Well, I mean, first, first I thought he was smoking something, right? I mean, because he said, okay, you know, we are doing, we're selling art and we're putting a rating on a picture or an artist. I said, you know, how do you do that? I mean, it's crazy because, you know, every collector will tell you collecting art is about emotions. It's look personal. At the picture, it's personal, it's very emotional, and you want to talk to the artist or to the gallerist and, you know, want to, you know, look at the picture. And but then, you know, after a few hours, I was convinced.
It was that quick.
Yeah, it was quick. It was quick. He had the arguments pretty much, you know, very much well structured. So I do believe it makes a lot of sense. And actually, when you say it's quick, when we are preaching our idea to other people, and it includes collectors, it includes gallerists, they can be convinced pretty quick as well.
Okay.
I mean, I think the idea is so well written down, and the whole scheme works in such a way that we can even convince people who, I remember meetings when for the first 10 minutes the guy would be screaming at us, really shocked. I mean, what? How can you do this? I mean, there's an avid collector who loves art, and he's like, how can you put numbers on it? I mean, are you crazy? And the last 20 minutes was like, great, you know, let's do it.
So I guess it's very important, you know, just to keep cool and be very patient with these people.
We used to the first reaction, which is always very negative. That's,
okay.
That's true.
And do you know where did he get the first idea from?
The first idea was how to help the young artists.
Okay.
Because the way the art world works today is that very few people, I mean literally few people, handful of people around the world decide who is going to make it and who's not. You have a few top art dealers and galleries around the world who will point at an art piece of art and say, this is great, and from then on, the success is guaranteed.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a very few people who, and these people obviously manipulate the market. They
play
with the market.
It's very subjective.
It's very subjective, and obviously since they are such a powerful, they are so powerful, and they push up the prices of these artworks, they have a lot of followers, so buyers or collectors who will always buy what this guy will recommend, and he knows
like
he will make money.
You on the Prague Stock Exchange in the 90s.
almost, except I didn't make those decisions, but I was just executing trades, but it's similar. And it's similar also to the fact that the art world is, until today, and nowhere in the world, it's not regulated.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no rules, there's no... No, if you get screwed over by a gallerist or an auction house, there's nowhere you can go to complain. Like you can go to the National Bank if you feel something was wrong with the financial product. But with art, it's not regulated, and so it's and that is why that's the whole idea of offering our platform for investment is we want to help those people who are thinking about investing in art, but are scared of that market. And clearly, I would be scared too if I didn't know it, because you know I read these stories about scandals in the art market around the world, and these include Sotheby's, Christie's, I mean big auction houses, I mean famous names, and there is a lot of scandals because each year something happens where people who are not familiar with the market, mm-hmm. They just get even more cautious that they don't want to invest, and we are trying to bridge that gap. We're trying to. Okay. To enable these people to invest with a very high level of comfort that what mm-hmm. they are buying, the quality is there and the potential is there and the investment makes sense.
So how do you find these young artists?
Well, basically what we do is we don't talk to artists directly,
okay.
Which is sort of an interesting one. We always go to gallerists. So we are, in each country, we're trying to focus on gallerists who are not just galleries like you see here in Prague, where you know, they're selling you know Charles Bridge pictures to tourists. We're talking about real gallerists who are representing these young artists. They take care of them, they invest in them, they organize exhibitions, they print catalogs for them. And so we go to them and we call them art partners, mm-hmm. and they will recommend their artists to us. And then we begin with a selection process, which consists of roughly 80 to 100 people we contracted around the world who are looking at this artist and his or her artworks and deciding whether it's good or not.
And they are professionals?
These are
this
professionals.
Field?
Okay. They are curators, they are art critics, they are gallery owners. I mean, these are professionals. And we try to get their opinion on a specific artist. So before, you know, we used to have 3-4 experts looking at it. But then we said we are elitist again. I mean, we again have three people deciding.
I was about to ask that.
Now we have 80, or we potentially want to have 300-400 of these people who will say this is great and this has a future. And then when that decision is made, whether yes or no, then we apply our rating and then we apply the numbers, so to say.
And I guess also you'll do the same with the galleries. The, you know, the more diverse group you have.
Sure, sure. And we obviously in each country we try to choose the best galleries who really take care of progressive new artists.
And what about, you know, the classical art? Do you have a vision for that to include
absolutely.
As well?
Oh, absolutely. It's actually interesting because when you talk to finance people, they will tell you, yes, a lot of people recommend art into portfolio as a diversification. So if I, obviously it doesn't make sense if you have a small portfolio, but once you have a bigger portfolio, you have shares, you have investment funds, you have some bonds, maybe you have some gold, real estate, and then art as a legitimate diversification tool because it keeps the value even if there's a financial crisis or inflation or currency movements. And but then they will tell you, yeah, but that's not true for the young emerging artists, right? They're not such a safe investment. So right now our platform has the young emerging artists, and that is more of an investment where you take some risk and there's a potential reward in terms of a yield or some profit when you really hit someone who is a future superstar. Mm-hmm. And from 1st of April, we'll launch a section where we will have we call it established artists, which is the famous names, the real stars, whether they are living or dead, okay. It's both. And so that section will open the 1st of April, and we will have collectors actually offering their artworks to the platform for sale. And again, we'll go through the same rating, et cetera, et cetera.
It seems like this market it has really a lot of problems. That's the reason why it was so long untouched.
Yeah.
You mentioned the solutions to some of them. I'm pretty curious about, generally the market itself is pretty illiquid.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you have the big names, you can go to an auction, you can probably sell it anytime, let's say.
Yeah.
But what about the young artists? Nobody knows it. I buy a picture on your platform.
Well, the whole platform is structured like a stock exchange. So you can, if you don't want to become a collector, you're just an investor, we enable you to buy and sell like on a stock exchange. So you buy, offer it for sale, you put your offer price and it's there for sale. Obviously, since it's an original and it's only one piece, it's not such a, there's never going to be such a liquidity as on a stock exchange, as a regular stock exchange. So what we are telling our investors, you're investing in an alternative asset. Is a physical asset, you're diversifying your portfolio, you're looking at least a 1 year holding period, which makes sense because it's actually pretty short, but compared to the stock exchange, it's very, very long. I mean, you can sell your shares tomorrow when you buy them today. But it makes sense because you buy a young artist, you need to wait until something happens. Mm-hmm. You know, he has a new exhibition or there was a positive critique written about him. He sold his other picture somewhere on an auction for a higher price. I mean, lots of things happening with the artist, but it doesn't happen overnight. So
okay, so I bought the picture. Mm-hmm. I set the limit price, which if it hits it, then it gets sold.
Yeah.
But and now the time goes. And you are quoting the price, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
no, the seller is quoting the price. We are not. We are just saying, you want to sell your picture for 3,000.
Okay.
And we are saying our market value estimate is somewhere in the range of. And then we'll tell the investor, we think it's lower than what you're saying or higher.
And the estimate is changing based on those inputs you
absolutely.
Have. So if you sell something for, 10,000, then your range goes up. And the idea is that the customer, a different one comes in and should buy it, right?
The issue obviously is we had to deal with a few issues like, for instance, manipulation, price manipulation, mm-hmm. since it's an illiquid market, and let's say you have an artist with only four artworks on the platform, it would be easy to manipulate the price. And so that's why we have an algorithm which has about 80 parameters, which we recalculate on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. And even if you try to increase the price by buying and selling that same artwork, let's say five times, it will not have such an effect mm-hmm. on our valuation. So if I'm an outside investor and I come to the platform, I will still see that picture that cost 3,000 a year ago, now it costs 20 because you pushed it up. Mm-hmm. The platform will say, don't buy it because we think it's only 3,200, the market value. So we're protecting those investors in order not to get screwed.
Okay, more transparency.
Yeah, transparency is key for us, absolutely.
And since you are a platform, most of the times the problem is, you know, you have a demand side, you have a supply side. Obviously, you can build up the supply side much easier. Mm-hmm. But this was a problem that, for example, Uber was solving. They were paying the drivers to sit around. What is your solution to bring up both sides of the market?
Well, interestingly enough, what we thought initially was we would have a problem on the supply side as well.
Okay.
Because, again, the main asset in the art market, apart from the artworks, is information. And so when we started to approach the galleries and ask them, you have to give us all the information, everything, all the prices that you sold the artist for, everything about the artist, we want all the information and for free. And we thought that would be difficult. Obviously, the first meetings were difficult, but once it picked up, now the galleries are very willingly joining the platform. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the supply side, the demand side is more of a challenge, because still it's an investment platform, right? It's something that doesn't work anywhere in the world. We're really new. We're really a blue ocean type of venture, mm-hmm. where I've had a lot of meetings with bankers offering the solution to the clients, and that was always the question. So is there a solution like this somewhere in the United States or in the UK? Mm-hmm. And I said, no, we're the first ones. Ah, okay. So we'll hold back and we'll wait a little bit. So obviously, they are conservative. But it's the main challenge is really now to spice up the demand, to generate demand from investors, which obviously involves getting more publicity, getting into the media, going to events, things like that.
Was this one of the reasons why the company is based in the UK?
The main reason for UK is one of the main reasons is also that, but it's also the fact that we were looking for investors, and the VCs are more comfortable, obviously, with the UK legal system than they would be with the Czech system. So the holding companies in the UK, we have the operating entity here, and that's how we work. So the our investors are in the UK company.
And so who is actually the ultimate customer? Somebody who wants a new picture, mm-hmm. is it the young artist or is it the gallerist? Who has the motivations, mm-hmm. the biggest motivations to use you?
Well, I think what you mentioned about the supply side, clearly artists and galleries are interested. We are getting emails every day, hundreds of emails. I want to join your platform. How do I do it? So on the supply side, we have a lot of interest because these young artists really don't have an easy life. On the demand side, obviously, the ideal customer is someone who... We have two of them, actually, because although it's structured as an exchange, as a trading platform, it's great for collectors as well. Because mm-hmm. the collector comes to the platform and he will see all the information about the artist. He can read his CV, he can read all the critiques about him, he can see all the list of exhibitions. So he will get a lot of information about the artist that he likes. And he has the opportunity to buy the artworks, have them at home, hang them at the wall, and just sit on them and without trading with them. So that's an option as well. So we like the collectors and we like the financial investors as well. Obviously, in terms of the numbers, there's much more potential investors than there are collectors.
And what about the auction houses? Do they view like really strong competition?
Right now, we are still, except for some Czech auction houses, we are luckily most of the time below their radar. Although it was interesting when we launched the platform, we were looking. We sent out some emails to lots of contacts, and we saw people from some lawyers from Sotheby's checking out the platform a few times. So it was interesting. So they looked at it. Obviously, we're going against the auction houses. That's clearly a different concept. We don't believe the auction system has been here for about 300 years. Mm-hmm. And we don't believe it's sustainable long-term, because that is really something where the price manipulation and the false bids and all those scandals that happen every year, I think is due to be out.
So is it maybe the, you know, your ultimate goal to drive them out of the market?
Absolutely, yeah. We want to replace the auction system with our system, definitely.
And what about the long-term vision of ARTSTAQ? Is it like one platform for all different, you know, not just paintings?
We are looking at actually what I forgot to mention, like on 1st of April when we launched the section with the more established art and artists, we are also launching a glass section, which is an extremely interesting market. Funnily enough, the demand is mostly in Western Europe and the US. The
supply from
the makers are in Czech Republic. They are the number one, I believe, the Czech glassmakers. And so it will be a very exciting time when we launch the glass section as well. And clearly the platform and the algorithm and the whole system is suitable to deal with other things as well. So we could look at old cars, watches, collectibles. It works everywhere. It's all items or it's all goods that are being traded today in an unregulated market with risk of manipulation and price fixing, etc., non-transparent market. And that's where we are trying to replace these old systems with our platform.
And so it's interesting, you were at the intersection of, you know, corporate business, arts and startups. Is there anything, you know, common or something that business people can learn from the artists or vice versa? That you noticed?
I don't know really from the artists, because I know some of them, but not from ARTSTAQ. I know them personally. I don't really think we can.
So is it doesn't very come different, to mind different world?
Yeah, it's a very different world. It's a very different world. The artists, obviously, they have a very different mindset and a very different way of thinking. That's why, you know, they are artists.
So if you try to, you know, tell them, yes, we are doing this, and you start explaining, they're like, you know,
that's why we work with the galleries, okay. Because they at least have some.
So they are the connection business. Between the business
absolutely.
World and the art.
Absolutely, absolutely. We almost always avoid talking to the artists directly. We have the galleries as the intermediary and as our main partner. Who is then managing his artists. He knows how to do that. We wouldn't know.
Hmm. Okay. Let's look at the questions that we have. I will start with the top one. What do you think about the recent Auctionata financial collapse and the fact that Sotheby's lost about $65 million in the past 6 months? I didn't even know about this.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. It's news. Actually, I think it's from Monday that Auctionata is. If you don't know, is an internet platform for auctions. So you can bid in auctions online. Auctionata filed for insolvency, I think on Monday or last week. And I think it's interesting because for us it was always. From the platform design, for us it was like it's beautiful. You know, we always looked up to it. It's like, wow, they're doing a great job, right? I think the cost structure was just something that they couldn't. They did everything manually, and they collected all these artworks, and they appraised them, and then they shipped them. And I think the cost structure was really tough to sustain. Also, they were involved in a few scandals where the founder was and his wife were putting in bids in auctions to increase the price. They did it under different names, so there were some scandals.
They were basically just taking the old structure of selling art online, but didn't change the...
They didn't change anything. It was still auction. Right? It was still auctions. The fact that Sotheby's lost, that happens every once in a while because they... that's part of the sort of manipulation with the art market where Sotheby's provides guarantees. If I'm a huge collector and I know and I own a huge collection of art, and let's say in a value of 100 million, I go to Sotheby's and I said, I want to auction it in your house, and but I want a guarantee.
Oh, for minimum price?
For a minimum price. Okay. So Sotheby's actually, when they see the artworks are not selling, they have to bid themselves. Hmm. And if that happens, they sometimes, if they're not lucky, they can lose a substantial amount of money. And that happens to Christie's, to Sotheby's.
They should use your platform for the price estimate, you know.
True. But it's a very, you know, it's competitive for them, between them, Philips and Christie's, so it happens.
Next one. What is the main difference or advantage of ARTSTAQ against other art trading models? I don't know if there are any different ones.
There's, as I said, if you want to buy art today, you can go to a gallery and buy directly from the galleries, or even if you're lucky, you know, the artist, you go to his shop and buy directly from the artist, which is actually, I think, a great experience, because then, you know, we have the personal connection, and I love that. I did that a few times. But the standard model is you go to a gallery or you go to an auction house. And
there are some platforms online, like Art Banana, for
they
example.
Are, these platforms are e-shops.
Yeah,
so,
it's an e-shop.
It's a one-time thing. So they buy you can buy it. You can buy the art that you like. Art Banana is doing a great job, for instance. I mean, we like them. We talk to them. And but it's an e-shop. Mm. So it's really just for collectors. You want to buy a piece of art, you want to hang it at home. Whereas we are providing something that is much more complex because of the data and because of the trading possibility.
But can I still hang the picture from you?
Oh, absolutely. You can still do that. You can still do that.
Will it be like for an extra fee or?
No. Well, the extra fee is the transportation.
So and then the risk that something happens to it, right? Because I guess if it's at your place, then.
That could happen. Yeah. Okay. That could happen.
What's your marketing go-to-market strategy?
Well, we had to tweak it a little bit. As I already mentioned, we went to the banks first, but the bank said, well, we want to see how you do before we join. I should have known it.
So that means you are now targeting more like retail clients?
We are more targeting retail clients. We are in the process of building our own sales network and in different countries. And these are people who have the sales ability, they have the network to approach clients. But very soon, since this is taking off now and we have some liquidity there, we are going to approach the banks again because they still remain our main target in terms of distribution of the platform.
And this switch of the strategy worked out? Probably, right?
No, yeah, I mean, but that's where we are now. We found out the hard way after, you know, 6 months of lots of presentations
we need to
change the strategy, yes. Absolutely.
And what are the markets that you're targeting? Is it like America or Europe?
Right now we're focusing on Europe, Latin America, and then obviously US will be the last once we although I'm wrong because, for instance, with the glass, the U.S. market is actually one of the first ones we're targeting. So it's different in each segment.
And I'm curious, why Latin America? You
know, Latin America is a huge market in terms of supply. They have some great artists there, great galleries that we have there. Obviously, in terms of investors, is not that significant yet. But we believe that will also happen there.
And what about China? They have a lot of buying power.
China is definitely a key market, but it's also a challenging one. So for China, you have to be very well prepared in terms of your local contacts, in terms of the platform. Obviously, has to be all in Chinese. They will not look at our English platform. So there's a lot of challenges that we that are there, but we're definitely looking at China right after Europe, basically.
And just to fully answer the question, so your strategy is a combination of like online presence and offline sales reps that, that build the network.
Yeah. Obviously, the online is key, right? I mean, the offline salespeople are important, but in the long term, we need to be really online mainly. So, but that for that we need publicity. We need to go to a lot of events. We just we're going to Amsterdam in May. We need to spread the word about our platform. It's obviously, as every startup knows, it's not so easy.
So you have some people on the platform that bought the pictures. Are they generally from Europe or US?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So is it like
we have some clients who bought it online. So they found out about us online and they invested. But the majority were still done with the offline sort of sales force right now.
And I haven't touched one important thing. Mm-hmm. How do you make money actually?
That's an important one. Yeah. If you go to a auction house to sell your picture, let's say you own a picture, inherited a nice picture, go to an auction house, the auction will be, let's say, 100,000 crowns. You as a seller will receive 80,000 because they charge the seller. And then the buyer who bid 100,000 will pay 125,000, let's say, because they charge the buyer as well. It's called seller's commission, buyer's commission. We charge the buyer's commission only. So we don't charge the seller, we charge the buyer. And that's where we make money. Mm-hmm. That's basically for each trade. So if you're selling a picture on our platform, let's say for 3,000, the final price the client will see is, let's say, 3,500 or something like that. So
is it like dynamic? This fee, or is it fixed? Doesn't matter if I buy
it's
something
fixed.
For 1,000 or 1,000,000.
It's a fixed percentage from the price of the artwork, mm-hmm. which decreases with increasing price of the artwork. So the more expensive artworks have a lower commission percentage-wise than the cheaper ones.
What do you think is the biggest advantage of investing in arts?
Well, I think I mentioned that. First of all, it can be a pleasure. It can be a pleasure. I mean, you can buy art, hang it, and I can tell you from my experience, and I think many people could confirm that, looking at a framed poster from IKEA and looking at an original, even from a young artist, is a very different feeling. His soul and his thoughts went into that. It's an original that he did, and so it's a very different feeling. It doesn't have to be an expensive one. It can be something you bought for 10,000 crowns, but it has still a different feeling. So that's the pleasure part. And in terms of investing, as I said, it holds value. It's something where the artist doesn't go bankrupt. The pictures don't go to zero. If you bought something. And if you, I'm talking about a young artist, especially if you hit the next Picasso, I'm exaggerating, but it doesn't have to be a Picasso, but there are a lot of young artists today that have already made it in the global scene, and they are very expensive. So if you find somebody who becomes successful, your investment, your return can be in thousands of percents, obviously. So
how many paintings do you have?
At
personally,
home?
Yeah.
Personally, well, I bought only when I was testing ARTSTAQ, I bought one there. Most all pictures that I have at home, I have about 50 that I bought before I joined ARTSTAQ, obviously.
Well, that's a lot. So somebody was searching your mail address today. I don't really understand the question.
I don't understand.
Maybe you can ask if you are sitting here.
If you need the mail address, I'd give it to you afterwards. I don't know. It's not secret.
No? Okay. So you were on the both sides. What's the main difference between being an investor and an entrepreneur?
Well, I really don't consider myself an experienced investor. I mean, I've made a few small angel investments. Clearly, being an entrepreneur is much more difficult. It's, uh, In this case, obviously, I'm not talking about professional people who work in VCs or that's a different story. But for me, it's obviously clearly much more challenging to be an entrepreneur since I've never done it. So
What is your inspiring message to the other entrepreneurs? I know you said at the beginning you are not an entrepreneur, but sure you have a lot of lessons.
Well, I had a discussion here with a nice guy before, and he asked me what would you have done differently. I don't regret the corporate experience. Most part of it was fun. It was interesting. I should have left the bank probably 5 years earlier. To start earlier, that was my only. But as I said, this room is probably full of entrepreneurs that I can't really advise them.
Don't be afraid and start.
Absolutely.
You don't need to sit in the corporate.
Absolutely.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, please a big round of applause for
Thank you
Jozef
very much.
Barta.
Thank you very much.